I was very pleased when your statement today used the term moral clarity, because I think we've been missing that for the last 8 years. And that's why I asked you about whether Vladimir Putin was a war criminal, something that you declined to label him as. I asked about China, whether they were one of the worst human rights violators in the world, which, again, you didn't want to compare him to other countries. I asked about the killings in the Philippines. I asked about Saudi Arabia being a human rights violator, which you also declined to label them. And the reason was not because I was trying to get you involved in the name of international name calling, but for the sake of name calling, but because in order to have moral clarity, we need clarity. We can't achieve moral clarity with rhetorical ambiguity. I also did it in pursuit of realism, because here's what's realistic. You said that you didn't want to label him because it would somehow hurt our chances to influence them or our relationship with him, but here's the reality. If confirmed by the Senate, as you run the Department of State, you're going to have to label countries and individuals all the time. You expressed today support for the Magnitsky Act, which specifically labels individuals and sanctions them. You are going to have to designate nations as sponsors of terrorism or organizations as terror groups. Again, a label. And one that I think a lot of us care about is the Trafficking in Persons Report, which specifically labels countries and ranks them based on how good a job they're doing. And that one really concerns me, because in that one, over the last year, there's evidence that the rankings and the tier system has been manipulated for political purposes. They upgraded Cuba, they upgraded Malaysia, because we're working with them now to improve relations, and we didn't want to have a label out there that hurt the chances of doing that. And so that's why I think it's important for you to, but here's the last reason. You gave the need for a lot more information in order to comment on some of these. And believe me, I understand that it's a big world, there's a lot of topics. These were not obscure areas. And I can tell you that, number one, the questions I asked did not require access to any sort of special information that we have. All these sources were built on voluminous open source reporting, rights groups, the leaders sometimes themselves when it comes to the Philippines, the State Department, etc. And we're not going off news reports alone. But the selling point for your nomination has been that while you don't have experience in government and in foreign policy, you have traveled the world extensively. You have relationships all over the world, and you have a real understanding of some of these issues as a result of that. Yet, today I've been unable to get you to acknowledge that the attacks on Aleppo were conducted by Russia, and that in fact they are or would be considered under any standard human rights, that somehow you're unaware about what's happening in the Philippines, that you don't or are not prepared to label what's happening in China and Saudi Arabia, a country that, my understanding, you're quite aware of. Women have no rights in that country. That's well documented. If you visited there, and anyone who has, they would know. Now, I want you to understand this too, and I said this to you when we met. I have no questions about your character, your patriotism. You don't need this job. You didn't campaign for this job. It sounds like a month and a half ago, someone had said that you were going to be up here today. You'd say, that's not true. That's not what there's only one reason for you to be sitting behind that table today, and that's your love for this country and your willingness to serve it. And I do admire that. I do. But I also told you when we met that the position that you've been nominated to is, in my opinion, the second most important position in the U.S. government, with all due respect to the vice president. It is the face of this country for billions of people, for hundreds of millions of people as well. And particularly for people that are suffering and they're hurting. For those people, those 1,400 people in jail in China, those dissidents in Cuba, the girls that want to drive and go to school, they look to the United States. They look to us, and often to the Secretary of State. And when they see the United States is not prepared to stand up and say, yes, Vladimir Putin is a war criminal, Saudi Arabia violates human rights, we deal with these countries because they have the largest nuclear arsenal on the planet, because China's the second largest economy in the world, because Saudi Arabia is a strategic partner in what's happening in the Middle East, but we still condemn what they do. It demoralizes these people all over the world, and it leads people to conclude this, which is damaging, and it hurt us during the Cold War, and that is this. America cares about democracy and freedom as long as it's not being violated by someone that they need for something else. That cannot be who we are in the 21st century. We need a Secretary of State that will fight for these principles. That's why I asked for these questions. That's why I asked those questions, because I believe it's that important for the future of the world that America lead now more than ever.